Well, if you're from Jamaica, Queens, you love funk. And welcome to the premiere episode of Jamaica Funk. That's what it is. I'm your host, Gail Lewis, and sitting with me tonight on the set of Jamaica Funk are two, well, proprietors of funk, if you will, from Jamaica, Queens, who have lived in Jamaica, Queens. So thank you so much for joining me, Camille and Akili.
No pleasure.
Thank you for having
Camille
me.
Camille Gainer, drummer extraordinaire, all genres, straight across the board.
Yes.
The love of drums, and of course, Akili Walker, new author, well, relatively new author.
Yes, new author.
Drummer, and most importantly, sound engineer.
Yes.
So you guys, welcome to Jamaica Funk.
Thank you.
So tell us, Camille, you're just a girl from Queens, to quote the title of your newest CD. What is Jamaica Funk for you?
Oh, well, Jamaica Funk for me is, where I got my music from, where I learned about music. I learned about excellence there. Mm-hmm. You know, it was such a high level of music, and, Queens was known as home of the basement bands.
Yeah.
Because there was a band on every block. So, and just the diversity, you know, you could be a funk band, or be a rock band, or be a jazz band, and, you know, I went to see a lot of the elders play there. There was like really some really great jazz clubs at that time when I was growing up, like Gerald's and another place, the Village Door, and Carmichael's. And I would go there as a kid, and most of the time Gerald's, I would sit out. I couldn't get in, but I would ride my bike up there. Yeah, I would ride my bike up there.
You could still hear the music.
Yeah. Look through the window.
Look through the window.
See Roy Haynes or Chico Hamilton, or, you know, that level of drummer. So. Yeah, for me, that was my development, and just, you know, a whole understanding of music and how to carry yourself, and just love of music, really. I just shedding all day. There's so many diverse musicians, and they would welcome you, you know.
Yeah.
There was, you know, they wanted to help you. And they,
had an interest. They really just wanted to help you.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you had a lot of competition too. I mean, it wasn't that simple, but I mean, a lot of the elders definitely, you know, welcomed you.
They drag you up.
Yeah. Well, you know, then it wasn't that you had to be able to play for it, let you get up there. Mm-hmm. They let you play, but if you was, you know, if you were going down, you had to get off and come back another day.
Akili, Jamaica Funk, what's that mean to you?
Well, Jamaica Funk is a community of great musicians. Everyone from Denzel Miller to Donald Blackman to Barry Johnson to Winky Flight. Mm-hmm. Musicians that have contributed to about 90% of the music that you hear throughout the world.
You think that it all has some root back in Jamaica, Queens?
Yeah, I think it was all related, the generation before the Jamaica Funk Cats, which we call our community, were classic musicians like Lena Horne, James Brown, Fat Waller, Count Basie lived in Queens, John Coltrane lived in Queens, and you know that
whole Aslan Park section,
exactly.
The big houses,
yeah, exactly,
and why they lived there because.
Upwardly mobile neighborhood
true.
Where
that they were allowed
African Americans to move, and they were making money. That was like, you know, that was a beautiful neighborhood to live in.
Yes,
they kind of pioneered it.
Yeah, you absolutely. Know. So I mean, Queens has just got this history, this it rich
does.
History of funk.
It does. It does, and it continues through the new generation. You know, the Nicki Minaj's, the 50 Cent's, the Ja Rule's, the. Who was preceded by Run DMC and LL Cool J. So the saga continues, and the music continues there in Queens.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you guys both grew up in Queens at some point, Cambria Heights.
Yes.
Both
Cambria
of you
Heights
guys.
Around the corner from
I know. But did you guys know each other back in the day?
No.
When did you meet?
Queens, New York has been one of the.
Do you remember?
Mutual. We know so many of the same people.
Exactly.
You know, the parties, the industry parties. You know, I I used to go to those like almost every night.
And you guys had the drums in common at that point.
We had the drums, and in the past couple of years, we've had new projects in common, and, and we've worked with each other in terms of promotion. Camille and her partner, Davey DMX, did an album in the 80s, was it?
In the 90s, yeah.
Okay, a beat record, which I use in my audio version of my book. In between chapters, you'll hear Camille's beats in between chapters. And so, you know, we've gained this relationship throughout the past couple of years.
And let's just introduce the book, too, since you brought it up.
It is.
The book, Akili Walker, Turn the Horns On.
Yes.
Was this your first book, Akili?
Yes, it is my first book.
And why'd you write this book?
A friend of mine named Larry Smith, who is who I call an architect of hip hop, who produced the early Run DMC albums, the the Curtis Blow albums, and Houdini albums.
All the good back in the day rap.
Yes.
Yeah, early days of rap.
Correct. Mm-hmm. And he is a musician from Queens and a Jamaica Funk out, a bass player.
Yeah.
And
bassist. Oh, jeez.
And he suggested to me one day I write a book.
About when was this?
This was about 8 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I was like, write a book. What are you talking about? I'm an engineer.
Mm-hmm.
But I took the challenge and I started writing.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the what came out of it.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And so now what happened to him?
He's had two strokes since then. Mm-hmm. It's kind of profound that he told me, he suggested that I write a book.
Right.
And today he cannot talk.
Yeah. So you're kind of like his voice through this
exactly.
book.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
It's funny how things work out.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It is.
So you wrote a book, and we're going to get back to the book in just a moment. And Camille, you've been drumming your whole life. When did you first pick up your sticks? Do you remember?
Yes, I was 8 years old.
Oh, wow. Why the drums? What led you to the drums?
It just resonated with me. When I would hear other people play the drums, I just knew it was something I could do. And I just bugged my parents, you know, to get first. I mean, I went through quite a few instruments, guitar, violin, but that was because I wanted the drums. And I I'm very glad that I got the opportunity to play piano and things like that, because it helped me, you know, further on as far as writing and things. So my father was a New York City police officer, housing cop rather, and he would come in late, 2-3 in the morning.
Right.
And I would leave these brochures with drums on his night table with the drums that I wanted circled.
Sears catalog.
Yeah, man. I was like, this was what I want.
Yes.
And so I would keep doing that. And then one day, it was my birthday, actually. He came in at 3 or so in the morning. He woke me up and he said, come downstairs, I want to show you something. So, you know, get woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning, you think you're in trouble. What did I do? I didn't do anything today. So I would go downstairs, looking all sad. He said, look, what I got you. And it was a drum set.
Oh my gosh, you were all of 8 at this point?
Yeah.
It's beautiful. And we have a little bit, a clip of a documentary. You want to clue us in about what that's about?
Recently, been working on a documentary along with Barry Johnson, a Jamaica Funk Cat bass player.
Yes.
And Bill Adler, former publicist for Def Jam Records. And Keith Powell. And we've been producing a movie called Jamaica Funk, Something in the Water. And it talks about three genres of music from Queens and how each genre contributed to the next.
What were the three genres?
It was the first generation of Billie Holiday, James Brown, who migrated there to Addisley Park.
Addisley Park, right.
And then it was the Jamaica Funk Cats, Camille Gainer.
Yes.
And
all of your contemporaries.
All the contemporaries.
Yes.
And the third generation, which is the Run DMCs, the LL Cool J's, Salt and Pepper's, Nicki Minaj.
All the people from Hollis and South and Southside.
So we talk about how one genre of music contributed to the
to
next.
To the next. They just kind of fell into each other. Oh, man.
Yeah, so, over.
Yeah, we have a clip from the documentary.
Okay, great.
So let's cue this up and let's show this clip of this great documentary, Jamaica Funk. It's in the water.
Yes.
Oh my!
Queens, New York, has been one of the great incubators of African-American musical talent for the last three generations. Starting in the 1940s, it was the home of such Hall of Fame achievers as Fats Waller and the godfather of soul, James Brown. In the late 60s and 70s, a new generation born in Queens began to emerge. They were called the Jamaica Funk Cats. By the 80s, yet another generation of musicians, starting with Run-DMC, LL Cool J, and Salt-N-Pepa, began to turn the world around. How did so much talent emerge from one community? Perhaps it was something in the water.
What's in the water, Akili?
Funk, music.
Jamaica Water is on the phone right now. They want to talk to you. I just need to, all right, they're in the booth. They're pissed because you're saying something's in the water. But really,
well, if I can figure it out, I would bring it to some other communities and have one big jam session, won't you think?
Absolutely.
I mean, until you see something like that where you see all of the names just rolling and scrolling and scrolling, it seems never ending. Yeah. You tend to forget. Especially because I live in Queens.
Mm-hmm.
You guys have lived here. You tend to forget that so much talent came out of Queens.
Yes, yes.
And continues to come out of Queens.
Mm-hmm. One thing we would like to do is to nurture some of that new talent that's out of Queens with the help of the Jamaica Funk Cats. Mm-hmm. We like to start a foundation in the name of Larry Smith where musicians could come and study, you know, not only music, but recording, video, and all parts of media.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's what we're trying to do.
It sounds like a great idea, just to kind of pay it back to that next generation.
Exactly.
And also to make sure that we keep, I mean, we have this rich history at this point, to make sure that we keep propagating it.
Yeah, right. To pass it down.
Yeah.
That's what was done, you know, to me.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So
it was passed down to you how?
Well, verbally and just, you know, visually, seeing the elders play, playing myself, taking lessons, studying, seeking people out because had all these great people in the neighborhood and, you know, I would just go and knock on their door and introduce myself on my bike.
Well, that's the thing about Jamaica Funk. When I started out as an engineer, I met Denzel Miller, a keyboard player.
When did you start out as an engineer? Well, about what year was this?
73.
Okay, so in 1973, there was what, one black sound engineer?
No, there was a few of us.
And that was the guy with the tan?
there was a few of us, you know, but there wasn't many of us, especially as you go out on the road and you realize.
So how'd you get into sound, Akili?
I went to a jazz club, at 19 and didn't know what I wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
A jazz club called The East in Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
Two of the engineers were friends of mine and I saw what they were doing. I said, that's what I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where we started. That's where the career started.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, how'd you get into, you went on the road, did you stay in the studio, what happened?
Yeah, artist Lottie Lister Smith, who you worked with, said one day that he was looking for an engineer to go on the road with. So I said, me, I volunteer.
Yeah.
And I went on the road with him, and then I went out with Gil Scott-Heron, and then Jimmy Casterbunch. And at that point I said, well, I think I would like to be in the studio. And took a couple of classes for studio engineering and got a position at Music Farm Recording Studios in Manhattan. And that was the beginning of my recording career.
Wow. Yeah. And then from there into the studio, more work.
Yeah, I came into the studio when they were recording people like Cameo and Brass Construction.
Gosh,
Sky,
that was a great age too.
Yes. And I started bringing in bands after hours and started recording them and practicing. And a year I started engineering sessions myself. So I started working with Prince, Eddie Kendricks, James Brown, and several, Bootsy Collins, George Clinton. And that was the beginning of my recording career.
And Camille, the list of people that you've worked with, well, first of all, it's like you're bipolar. Isn't it?
The
list of people that you work with, before I was asking you how you would categorize yourself as a drummer, like how, you know, are you classical, are you funk, are you, and you had difficulty classifying yourself as what type of drummer you are, and now I understand why. You've worked with a myriad of people.
Yes, it's just music to me. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the classifications to sell, to market something. Mm-hmm. That's why it's classified.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But, you know, at its root, at its base, it's all music. It's organic, it's spiritual, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's just, for me, like I said, my love of music. And I love all genres, as long as it's good.
Mm-hmm.
You
yes.
know, I can go be overseas and hear any band and, yeah. you know, a whole completely different style, or go out in the bush and, you know, take out, you know,
go
out
there.
Yeah. I think that's important. I think that's important to have as a musician, staying yeah. open.
Mm-hmm. And that versatility. You've worked mm-hmm. with people like Heavy D and Cyndi Lauper. I mean, what would these two people have in common, you know, in real life other than you? I mean, just such a diverse, both of you, just such a diverse mm-hmm. group of people.
Yeah, they excellence is what they ultimately seek.
Right.
You know,
so. And that's what they have in common.
Yes.
And so they seek you.
And music, yeah.
You know, we came up in the business at a great time. You know, mm-hmm. there was a lot of different genres of music that was mm-hmm. developed in the time that we started, you know, in the career. You had disco, you
right.
had soca,
mm-hmm.
you had, you know, house, mm-hmm. you had
the whole rap genre was you know
soul, R&B, straight ahead jazz, avant-garde jazz.
And we got a chance to work with all of them, mm-hmm. and you know that's how we survived. You
right.
know, you know, we were versatile enough. When there was a gig over here with a Cyndi Lauper,
right.
we'd do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we could handle it. When there was a gig over here with Heavy D, we'd do it. We could handle it. And that's how we were able to earn a living.
Mm-hmm. Talk to me just for a moment, and I know people might hate this about disco, because you were in that when it came up.
Right.
Talk to me about that.
That's one of my favorite. That was one of my favorite eras.
Mm-hmm. And you were in that era too, with the
coming up. Kind of. Uh-huh. I was in the tail end of it, basically, because I wasn't. Those clubs that people, you know, the discotheques, I wasn't old enough to go to those.
But you were listening to it on the radio. Right. And
oh, yeah, but I mean, the beats, one of the records my father brought home was MFSB.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, that was legendary. I mean, that break in itself, you know, mm-hmm. still to this day, my father said, well, you know, if you could play this, you could play. That was one of, you know, his
right.
favorite records, mm-hmm. you know.
So. That was one of the greatest eras, because first of all the musicians were working. Studios were booked 24 hours a day because all of the music was done live.
Right.
So you were in, just stop, we mm-hmm. were in a studio and there were musicians in the studio.
Correct.
Yes.
You know, you had not only the basic tracks of drums, keyboards,
mm-hmm.
and a guitar, but you brought
right.
in 35 string players, then you brought
right.
in horn players.
Yeah.
I mean, it was
it was
creative, and everybody mm-hmm. had their own styles of disco, mm-hmm. from
yeah.
chic to, you know,
Mahavishnu, what was the orchestra?
Electric Light
Orchestra.
Orchestra. Yeah.
Right, you know.
Dr. Bazaar's.
Savannah
Band, like everybody
great.
Was different.
Yeah.
They were all different.
And yet
it was all under the
umbrella disco.
Umbrella, yeah.
Yes.
But so many different types of music.
Yes,
yeah, Donna
yes.
Summer.
That is something.
Mm, yeah.
Oh, and then disco socks and all that other stuff. But that's
yeah, that was a whole other thing.
Oh my gosh! So let me just for a moment here.
I didn't understand it though.
Yeah, why did disco suck so much? It sounded
the rock and rollers.
Oh, okay.
Liked rock and roll, and I guess they would be in.
And they were the ones with
change.
The t-shirts. Disco
yeah.
socks.
Yeah.
Oh, that's sad.
The floor on the floor thing happening, but. If you really listen to it, there's a lot of, you know, variations on mm-hmm. the patterns. It's
yeah.
not just one thing.
There's a little bit of rock in there in disco.
Well, definitely, that's all
yeah.
a part of
yeah.
you know,
a lot
it's
of
all
live
part
guitars.
Of music we've created. You know,
mm-hmm.
you know, in the African American culture, that's we created rock, mm-hmm. jazz, R&B, hip hop, so mm-hmm. all of that. So
the original art form, American art form, jazz. Exactly. African American, completely.
Yeah.
And so there were not a lot of African American sound engineers back in the day. Is it different now?
Oh yeah, it's much different. I think because of the accessibility of the equipment now, mm-hmm. People have systems in their house.
Yeah.
They're able to record on a laptop.
Right.
And
back in the day, it was.
Yeah, it was $1 million studio, $2 million, $3 million studio.
So access and, limited.
It was limited. Yeah. Correct. And now access is more widely spread, and it's open up the genre for young engineers.
Mm-hmm.
Whether they call themselves engineers is another story. They might call themselves beat makers.
Yes, absolutely.
I think that's what the industry dubbed them.
Oh, that's
because
what the industry does.
Well, there's a difference between a beat
they
maker
make beats,
and a producer.
Right.
Correct.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, well, because there's a difference between a beat maker and a producer. Producers see the project mm-hmm. through. You know, a beat
produces
maker might just,
the product.
Yes,
yeah.
A person that's making a beat might just have a little track or, you know, mm-hmm. and that's it, but they really don't understand how to EQ everything, make it a song, hooks, mm-hmm. things like that. That's where the producer comes in and makes it a record.
And speaking of making records, let me just say, first of all, just the album art, I'm in love. There's a certain girl from Queens, Camille, and this is your newest CD.
Yes.
Is this your first?
Yes.
That's all you.
Yes.
You've been on lots of CDs before.
Yes.
But this is you front and center.
Yep.
Tell me about
band.
This. There's 14 tracks.
There's 14 tracks.
Who's your band?
My husband's on bass, mm-hmm. Dave Jones. On this particular CD, Bernard Wright is on there. Raymond Angry is playing keys. Mm-hmm. Lakeisha Benjamin, Patrick Moody on trumpet. Jazzy J on the mm-hmm. turntable. Mm-hmm. So, my live band is. We have Chris Hemingway on sax.
Mm-hmm.
So many. Jazzy J on the turntables.
Uh-huh.
My eclectic MC
mm-hmm.
as the rapper.
There's one rap on here.
Yeah.
And then you did some Lord vocals Swords. As well.
Yeah, one of the tracks is Dig This.
Uh-huh.
That has some vocals. The Jets, which is the new single.
Mm-hmm.
Those vocals I did, you know, that's like an old studio trick where you layer the vocals. So I did all the singing on it.
I love it.
Yeah.
And on the back of your CD, there's a picture of you. Where was this taken?
Well, that's in Jamaica, Queens, Cambria Heights. I grew up on that block.
This is 1993.
Yes.
This picture. This is right across the street from PS 147.
Yes, I used to go from
the Ronald McNair School.
I used to go from.
That's okay. I got it.
Okay.
Practicing all day to the handball court.
I love this.
Yeah.
So you're just a girl from Queens,
From Queens.
This is a great album. So this is out now.
Yes.
Where can we go for more information about you?
My website, www.CamilleGainerJones.com.
Uh-huh.
You can purchase the CD if you like to download it. It's on iTunes.
Okay.
All the download entities out there. And also, if you want a physical copy, you can get one from Amazon.
Mm-hmm.
Or,
it's everywhere. Yes. We just go to your website for more information.
Stores.
And you just look stellar on this. I mean, you look stellar in person. And I'm in love with this album art. Where did you take this picture on the front?
Oh.
Do you remember?
Yes. Claudia Hayden. Did the artwork.
Okay,
nice. She's great.
And not to be underdone, Camille, but Akili has his book out, which is 2 years old.
Yes.
Turn the horns on.
Mm-hmm.
This, which I love on the back that it says, it's an intimate account of sex, drugs, and redemption.
Yes, it is.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
And where can we find more information about you?
Well, the outlets like iTunes, mm-hmm. Amazon.
Yeah.
And you could go to www.turnthehornson.com.
Okay.
We have three versions. We have the audio book, mm-hmm. the Kindle version, as well as the paperback.
And I know in the audio book, we'll also get an extra surprise because there's a track by Camille on there as well.
There's several tracks by Camille. In between
awesome.
Each chapter,
uh-huh.
we have beats by Camille and Davey DMX.
Nice. Oh, nice. So that's drums and...
Well, there's bass, there's, you know, the instrumental tracks, some of drum tracks, some instrumental. It was a breakbeat record. We used to put out our own breaks, and this one's called Funky Presidents. So we used the Funky Presidents on the audio book.
So in this book, we've got Sex, Drugs, and Redemption. Talk to me about drugs and redemption.
Well, you know, I went through a battle with drugs for 20 years. I was addicted to cocaine. And it talks about my how cocaine, you know, affected my relationships, my work, and my life in general. And it talks about how I was able to recover from that and be clean for the last 20 years.
Amazing.
Yes.
When
yes.
did you get clean? 20 years ago, about how old were you?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. 40 years old.
So you were into it between 20 and 40.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, the prime time.
Yeah, all the lights were on.
Yes, I don't know who was home.
Did you back in the day in the studio, because you were in the studio at that point too? Was what was the drug culture like then?
Well, drugs were heavy. A lot of people were using drugs.
Yeah.
For me, I I used it to stay awake because, like I said, we were working 24 hours.
Yeah.
And for you know, recreational use as well.
And you never went down that road, Camille?
No, no, not to the, not, you know, I mean.
Yeah, to the point where, Well, that's great, congratulations on your sobriety. That's that's huge. Yeah, so what's next for you guys?
Well, I'm gonna be doing some shows in February.
February
2015. I have a video campaign going on now for the CD, so it's,
okay.
you know, it's being added now to a lot of radio stations, and I'm looking forward to working on the next record. That's what I'm doing now. And you know, playing and performing on the festivals coming up in 2015.
And Akili?
Well, we're working on the Jamaica Funk Something in the Water movie. That was the opening of the trailer. We hope to get financing for that in January and go ahead and shoot that movie.
Okay. When do you think finished product? Anytime, maybe 2016.
Yeah, hopefully by 2016 we'll have it.
Yeah,
done.
And you're shooting it mostly where? Tell me.
Queens.
All right. Any
Queens,
particular part?
Hollis, Jamaica, Cambria Heights.
There you go. Holla at me. All right, ladies and gentlemen, this has been Jamaica Funk. That's what it is. With me, Camille and Akili, thank you so much for joining me here tonight.
Thank you.
This has been so much fun. I wanted to keep going on, but we can't. But go listen to them and find them, and then when it comes out, go see the movie, because I'll be there opening night, hopefully on the red carpet, if I know somebody.
Yes.
I'm Gail Lewis, guys. Hit me up on my website, gail-lewis.com, for more information about me. Remember, Jamaica Funk, that's where it is. And tonight, it was right here on stage. Thank you so much for watching Jamaica Funk. We'll see you again real soon. Thank you, guys.
All right.